Herkese merhabalar. University of Southampton Business Webinarına hoş geldiniz. Ben İmran Mehmet, British Education Bureau BEB eğitim uzmanı olarak bugün sizlerle University of Southampton'dan yetkilimiz Rami El Musa ve akademisyenlerimiz, İşletme Fakültesi akademisyenlerimizle birlikte önemli konu başlıkları hakkında bilgiler aktarıyor olacağız. Ben sözü yetkilimiz ve akademisyenlerimize bırakmadan önce çok kısa olarak British Education Bureau'dan bahsetmek isterim sizlere. BEB, British Education Bureau olarak bizler Southampton Üniversitesi'nde Türkiye'deki resmi temsilcisiyiz. Temsil ettiğimiz üniversitelerin Türkiye'deki tanıtım faaliyetlerini destekliyoruz. Aynı zamanda Türkiye için içerisindeki organizasyonları gerçekleştiren kurumuz. 2002 yılında Oxford'da kurulduk. İngiliz ve Türk kuruculara sahip bir yapımız mevcuttur. Son 20 yıldır da İstanbul, Ankara, İzmir'deki ofislerimizde öğrencilerimize danışmanlık hizmeti sağlıyoruz. Uzmanlık alanımız tamamen Birleşik Krallık eğitim sistemidir. Üniversitelerin giriş şartları, başvuru süreçleri ve vize noktasında olmak üzere tüm aşamalar boyunca öğrencilerimize destek sağlıyoruz. Tüm danışmanlık kadromuz Birleşik Krallık eğitim sistemine hakim. Bu konuda devamlı olarak eğitimler alan bir kadrodan oluşmaktadır. Birleşik Krallık'ta toplam 130 tane devlet üniversitesi vardır. Biz BEB olarak 90'ının Türkiye'deki temsilciliğini, resmi temsilciliğini yapıyoruz. Ve temsil ettiğimiz üniversiteler için de tamamen ücretsiz danışmanlık hizmetimiz bulunuyor. Bundan sonraki faaliyetlerimizi, etkinliklerimizi internet sayfamız Instagram ve Facebook üzerinden takip edebilirsiniz. Aynı zamanda İstanbul, Ankara, İzmir ve Lefkoşa'daki ofislerimize de bu numaralardan ulaşabilirsiniz. Sunum sırasında veya sonunda merak ettiğiniz tüm soruları chatbox üzerinden veya sesli olarak el kaldırma butonuyla bizlerle paylaşabilirsiniz. Sunum sonunda tüm soruları birlikte yanıtlamaya çalışacağız. Thank you very much, Rami. It's yours now.
Okay, excellent. Thank you very much, Imran. Thank you, BEB, for the great organization of this event. My name is Rami Al Musa. I currently work for the University of Southampton as the Country Development Manager for the Middle East. Okay. Yeah, thank you. Welcome to the Business Insights Tour. I'm glad today to be joined by our distinguished academics from the business school, Dr. Rob Angel, Associate Professor in Marketing, Professor Parav Shukla, Professor in Luxury Branding, and Dr. Shahnaz Ibrahim, who will be joining us shortly, Senior Teacher, Teaching Fellow in Strategy and Innovation. Before I hand back to my distinguished colleagues, I'd like to talk briefly about the University of Southampton, about our business school. Southampton, a world-class business school. We're part of the Russell Group Universities, so the top 24 institutions for research in the UK, and very well regarded in Turkey as a university. Southampton is a top 100 university in the world. We're currently ranked 77th in the QS ranking and ranked in the top 20 universities in the UK overall. So currently our ranking is 14 in the complete university guide, and our business school is doing absolutely incredibly well as well, being in the top 20 business UK business school in the Guardian rankings for management and marketing, and top 10 for marketing in the 2021-2022 complete university guide. We're also top 40 in the world for operational research, and our programs are AAA, CSB, and AMBER accredited. And we receive, as a faculty, as a school of business specifically, we receive more than 24,000 applications from over 100 countries. I'm proud to say Southampton is a place where it's an environment for growth. 98% of our students are in graduate employment within six months, of completing their degree, meaning that we have lots and lots of links, and our Career Service Centre are very active in making sure that we help our students look for opportunities when they complete their degree with us. And the fact now that students are allowed to stay in the UK for up to 2 years on a postgraduate study visa means that you would have opportunities to even get a job in the UK. At the business school, we offer a wide variety of programs at the undergraduate and postgraduate level. Many of our popular courses are such as accounting and finance, business analytics, business entrepreneurship, marketing and finance as well. And we offer all the mentioned programs with a 3 or a 4 year, all our programs are 3 years and we offer them with a placement year as well. So students are able to work for a year while studying their undergraduate program for students interested in undergrads. For postgraduate programs, as you can see, these are only few of the programs that we have. We have more than 20 master's programs on offer, but these are some of the most popular programs that students from Turkey apply to. So international management, marketing management, business strategy, digital business, luxury brand management, and many, many other subjects. The good news I always get asked about is scholarships. Do we offer scholarships? Yes, we do. And I'm glad to say that the business school are one of the most generous faculties in the university. Thank you very much for offering these scholarships. So students with a very good GPA would qualify for a £3,000 scholarship. That'll be deducted from their fees. Students with an excellent GPA would qualify for up to £5,000. And obviously, in regards to entry requirements, it's good to check with myself, with Imran from BEB, and we can advise you on whether you'd qualify for a scholarship or not. Okay, let me come out of this screen. I'm going to share another screen with information with a short video. I'm actually going to play a very short video talking about, just for you to get a better understanding on what Southampton is. Just bear me a sec. Okay, so thank you very much, everyone. This is it for me. I'll be passing on to my colleague, Dr. Rob Angel, who will be giving his talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Rami. Can you see my slides? Are we all in place?
Yeah, we're in place.
Thank you so much. I very much appreciate everybody joining us this afternoon. Thank you. A warm welcome to all of you from us in Southampton and our beautiful campus, as hopefully you were able to see in the video that Rami's just shown. Thank you, Imran, for your hospitality and warm welcome as well. I'm going to talk, as will my colleague, Professor Parav Shukla, for 10 minutes or so to give you a little flavour of the type of education we try to offer in the Southampton Business School. Now, there's something that I would like to just mention before I go forward. Southampton is ranked 77th in the world, and it's also part of what we call the Russell Group of Universities, which means that we're in the elite of universities, but also that the education that we try to deliver is research informed and research intensive. That means that the education that you get from us is at the cutting edge of your chosen discipline, and that you will be best placed to move into industry and secure top jobs. And this is what our students do every time they leave our four walls of the university. They go and work for the big companies, they set up their own companies, and they go on and achieve amazing and remarkable things. And so Parav and I would just like to give you a little flavor of the type of thing that you can expect at Southampton. Now, we only have 10 minutes together, so we're just going to give a very gentle introduction to a particular area. And I'm going to talk about something that's very dear to me, but also probably something that many of you have thought about in your everyday lives, okay? Now, the title of my talk is How to Win Friends and Influence People, Revisited. And in particular, I want to give you three very, very easy and subtle ways that you can change how influential you are simply by the choice of words that you use in the language that you put into the world, okay? And so hopefully you can walk away from today's talk and maybe action these and put them into practice, okay? But before we get going, let me just pose this little brain teaser for you, okay? Now you can see these four pictures with different groups of people. My question to you is, and just think about this for a few seconds, what do you think brings together or draws together these groups of people? What do you think is the common link between these four sets of pictures? Have a little think. Give you a few more seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay, so what draws these four groups of people together? Some of them, hopefully you've seen before, some of them you might not know, is they have all been, they have all been announced as fitting within the Time Magazine Most Influential People 2021. That means that they are in the elite, as seen by this magazine, of people who have the most influence in the world. And people obviously are dying to get onto this particular list. Now you'll notice from the pictures I've just shown you, and possibly the pictures you've seen here, that there's some common thread in the types of people who seem to get this. Now you might be thinking to yourself, huh, well these all seem like celebrity people. So is influence and celebrity the same thing? Well, it's a good question, but the answer to that is no, not quite. Now, while celebrity or fame is indeed the state of being widely known or recognized, being renowned, influence is something slightly different, because influence is the capacity to have an effect on the character, development, or behavior of someone or something. Now, think about it in this way. People who are famous can be indeed very influential. But all of us can be influential in our own way. In fact, I'm pretty sure that you have been influential and you have been able to have an effect on the character, the development, or the behavior of other people, be it your friends, be it people in your family, be it people at work. Now, the question becomes, if we can all be influential and we all have the ability to be influential, how do we best go about this in a way that is going to bring some positive outcomes to the world? Now, this point is very important because when we think about those people who have influence or those people who influence other people, many of us think of this as being something that's quite negative. But it needn't be that way. You might be, for instance, a salesperson who is so good at your job, you're able to see into the minds of your customers and find and present products and services to them that will change in a really tangible way their lives, their health, and their happiness. That's an art of being a good salesperson. But in the same way, you might be somebody who brings the best out of your team. We take Egyptian maestro here at Liverpool. We know that the manager, Jurgen Klopp, has done a brilliant job of influencing his team and getting the best out of star players. You might be a manager at work as well who manages to bring diverse teams together towards a shared goal. Or you might be able to influence people in such a way that they give up their time, their money, their expertise for pro-social, for good. For example, giving to charity or doing things in the world that really truly make a difference, okay? And you can see from this that influence is therefore a tool that is extremely desirable when it's used for good. But most of us don't know how to be influential organically. What that means is most of us don't know how to be influential without thinking about it. Now, there are, of course, some people in the world who are and have this great ability, but many of us don't know. And so the question becomes, how can we be more influential to the people that we are around? How can we be more influential to the people that we work with? How can we be more influential to people who we come across in our daily lives? Now, obviously, there are a universe of ways that you might be able to do this. And I have no means or ways of giving you all of the answers in one go. But we can start off with three very specific and easy ways that you might be able to do this in your daily lives, okay? Now, I'm gonna give you these three tips that are based on research evidence, okay? So these have been shown and proven through research and analysis. And the great thing about these is that all of them can be done without costing you anything, okay? All right, so let's try the first one. So the first tip is from the research of someone called Professor Anna Seller, who's at the University of Florida in the USA. Now, Anna has researched the importance of how we frame two types of pronouns. That is we and I, okay? So in everyday life, we say the words we, but we also may use I more regularly, okay? Now, Anna says that when you're working with teams and you're working with people, the choice of the words you use, either we or you and I, are very important. You might say to your team, you and I can do this together. Or you might say, we can do this together. Organizations also have this dilemma, this instance, okay? UBS, who's a big investment bank, they use the words you and us in their framing of the literature or the positioning that they put to their customers in their marketing. Wells Fargo, another bank, on the other hand, they talk about together we'll go far. So which one of these is right? Which one of these is better? Well, what Anna shows through his research is that when we use we over you and I, the people who we are talking to feel closer to one another. There's a greater sense of togetherness and shared experience. It also happens that people who say we more often are seen as more likable. And we know that people who are more likable are also more influential. Give that a go. Rather than you and I, try we. Number two, this is from Professor Jonah Berger at the Wharton School in America. He talks about whether or not we should use the present tense, it is, or the past tense, it was, when we describe things to influence people. So for example, if I ask you, one of your friends asks you about the cinema that you went to, or the film you went to see at the cinema recently, you might say that movie was great. Now, most of us would say this because it rolls off the tongue. It's easier for us to say. It comes more naturally to us. But you could grammatically say, yes, that movie is great, because the movie still exists. Similarly, if you went to a rock concert, you could say to your friends, the rock band were good at singing, okay? Because you saw it, that would come more naturally. But you could also grammatically correctly say, they are good at singing. So which one of these are right? Or which one of these can work better for you? Well, we normally will use it was over it is. But what Jonah Berger shows is that when we talk about things in the present tense, it is, people think that we know what we're talking about with more certainty and more concreteness. That means it's more solid, it's more reliable. The question is, to what extent? He shows that people who use the present tense tend to be seen as more authoritative and powerful on the things that they talk about than when they talk about them in the past tense. Number three, and this is me, by the way. Now, there's a little thing that we can do in the English language, which is to use something that we call a maximizer. Maximizers intensify, they increase and add something to the language you use. Words like, and you've heard of all of them, absolutely, totally, and completely are all examples of maximizers, okay? Now, we don't use them as much as we should, but here's the reason why we should do, okay? Now, imagine that you're a manager who's talking about their team, okay? You could say, our team is full of great people. That means that everybody in the team is a great person, right? But you could also maximize this even further by adding an absolutely, a completely, or a totally, and say, our team is absolutely full of great people. Now, even though a team that is already full of great people won't be having any more extra people that are great when you add an absolutely, we find that people believe that there are more people in the team who are great and are even greater than the opposite when you add the maximizer. We're seeing brands do this now as well. Rather than just saying no added sugar or no added salt, brands are saying absolutely no added sugar. Why? Well, this again gives the confidence to people that they are more confident in and concrete and certain in what they're saying. Okay? So it doesn't cost you anything to add a maximizer like this, but the implications can be really big. So three things that you can try. Number one, you can say we a little bit more often than I. Number two, try to say things in the present tense when it makes sense to do so. And number three, don't be afraid to throw an absolutely into the statements that you make when you're trying to influence somebody or bring them round to your way of thinking. Hopefully you can try those and they will be useful and interesting for you. Next up, we have Professor Parov Shukla, who is a professor of luxury branding in the School of Business here at Southampton. Over to you, Parov.
Thanks very much, Rob. I guess everyone can hear me. I'm just going to share my screen. We will talk about for about 10 minutes. And I want to ask you a question, first of all, before we go forward. And the question will pop up in a minute. But before we go there, I guess you all know this guy, Tom Hanks. And, you know, he did a movie called Angels and Demons. And I've just added another title to it, saying angels and demons both wear Prada. And that's how it works. In my lab, with my co-authors, with my PhD students, we do a lot of work on luxury brands. We do, for the last 1.5 decades, we have been studying luxury and luxury brand. And it brings out the funny thing about luxury is it brings out the darkest and the brightest side in human endeavor. In a way, humans behave the best way, angelic ways, as well as in the demonic ways when it comes to luxury. And I'm going to share a few stories with you. And in a way, I strongly believe in that Arabic tradition of, you know, storytelling, because stories are something that we remember. Most of the time, if somebody tells you the theory, you don't, but you remember a story. And so that's what we are going to do today. But before we do that, I want to ask you a few questions, or rather one question. Would you like to hear modern stories or would you like to hear historical stories? So if you can type in your chat box, you know, historical or modern, that would be amazing. So go for it. Okay, I'm getting more historical right now. A few moderns coming in, modernists coming in. I like that. Okay, both. Oh, that's a good idea, Fulia. Yeah, brilliant. Okay, yeah, I'm getting more historical. So let me tell you, you know, a few stories, and we will see, you know, if time permits, I'll tell you in the next 8 minutes or so, a few stories around luxury brands, and we will decide where we go. I'm seeing a lot of historical. So let's start with a historical story that emerged in Arabia. And the first story I want to tell you about is this person. I guess you probably know, in a way, the photograph. It's a pharaoh, it's a mummy, you know, a sarcophagus and all that stuff. But I want you to imagine, you know, if you're in early 20th century, you're this archaeologist called Howard Carter. And you walk into this little cave type of an opening, an Egyptian worker has opened for you. You look in there, and what you find is that as you remove the dirt and all that, you start seeing a yellowish thing. And you think, okay, yellow, interesting. But then when you start looking a little deeper into it, you realize that this is gold. And you think, wow, you know, I have found a gold mine. But it's not a gold mine. You start opening more and more of that cave. And what you find is that this is a door. And then you go further and further. You start removing even more of that dirt. And you start seeing that this is not just a door. It's a whole bloody room that is made up of gold. And you think, my God, this person who has done it must be very rich. You know, very luxurious lifestyle this person would have if they have been able to create a cave of gold. And so you slowly open that door. And you open that door, and what do you find, you know? Inside that door is another door, which is made up of gold again. And so you start cleaning that up, and you think, my God, you know, a room within a room which is made up of gold. You know, it's like those Russian dolls. That one doll, you open one doll and there is another doll and there is another doll and so on and so forth. And you open that second door and you find the third door. And that is also made up of gold. And you start seeing it and you get excited. You feel, my goodness me. And, you know, and when you open that third door, you see a sarcophagus. And that sarcophagus looks something like this, what you see in this picture. In a way, Egyptians knew, or Arabic world knew, how to do luxury long, long time ago. You know, they've taught many parts of the world what luxury feels like. And when I visited recently, you know, or rather just pre-COVID, Istanbul and, you know, Ankara, you know, when I look at those cities, I could see the kind of luxuries that you all are having, you know. And in some sense, it captures the essence that we all wish for a luxury good at some point in time. Some of us don't, but many of us do. For example, you know, if I tell you that here are two pens I have on my hand, and I'm just finding one, yeah. So here is a pen which says University of Southampton. I hope you can see it in these filters. It's very hard to see. And here is a pen which says Cross, you know, and you, if you don't know either of these brands, it may not be a great choice for you. You know, you may choose one or the other. But now if I tell you that this is a University of Southampton pen and it is made up of plastic versus this is a Cross pen and it costs you about $300, suddenly your perceptions have changed. And that is what we study in my lab as to how perceptions change when we do different things, when we provide different triggers. And we see this all the time from historical times to now. So that's the first story, you know. But let me ask you this question. Okay, this is my second story. And I'm going to finish in about the next 3 or 4 minutes. So, you know, stay with me for this. If you can tell me what this table is made up from, we will be happy to give you potentially a scholarship. Can you tell me what this table is made from without searching on Google? Just go for it. Type it out. What do you think this table is made up from? Okay, I'm seeing Ali saying wood and Cengiz saying wood and Doyan saying steel, maybe. Yeah, rosewood, brick. That's a good idea, Muhammad. It looks like brickish color, isn't it? And clay and, oh, velvet. That's a very interesting idea, Pamir. Okay, clay, oak, uh-huh. Yusuf says, anyone else? Oak, ivory. Ah, that's a good one, Dennis. Yeah. Well, like I told you, it would be very easy. If it was easy, then my God, that would be the easiest scholarship you ever got. So right now, a lot of interesting, oh, meat. I like that note. That's a very clever thinking to do. Fantastic. And lace and leaves. Fantastic. So in reality, this table is made up of a product called lacquer. I don't know if you've seen, you know, in old times or even still in modern times, in legal terms, when you want to seal something, when you want to put a paper seal on something, you do it with lacquer. You know, there is this red colored blob and you put this hot thing on a hot, you know, stamp it on it and you stamp that and it becomes your seal. And lacquer is a funny product. This product is liquid or semi-liquid when it's hot. And when it is cold, it becomes very brittle. It becomes solid, but it becomes very, very brittle. So you can't carve on it. Okay. And what you are seeing in this table is nothing but carvings. And this was done in the 12th century in China. We don't even know now how this table was made. You know, this is something amazing that is happening in the world right now, you know, and we don't know, even with all these modern technologies, we are unable to replicate this. This is luxury. And then, you know, so I've shared with you two bright examples of luxury. I want to share with you one little dark example of luxury also. I told you luxury brings the brightest and the darkest, angels and demons both in us. And here is another example. So if I may ask you again, and everyone, come on, give me a chance on this one. And I want you to be right on this time. What is the most luxurious object in this picture? Go ahead. What is the most luxurious object in this picture? Denise says feathers. Pamir's culture, mosaic, okay. Uh-huh. What else is coming up? Come on, jewelry, headwear, gold. I like that. Fabulous. You see, our ideas of luxuries are very, very common, right? Diamonds, gold, sapphires, rubies, right? The person potentially, yeah, the person is a king in a way, right? But Denise, you really nailed it. It's the feathers, you know, that's the most luxurious object because the person is obviously important, but he's not an object. He's a person in some ways. You can define and you can objectify him, but the feathers are important and the most luxurious item in here. And the reason is that the bird which gave these feathers could only produce two or three feathers in its lifetime, the quail, as it is called. Do you see the amount of feathers on this person? You can realize how many people will have to die or how many birds will have to die for this person to have this head garb, you know, and you can see on the picture on the left-hand side, you know, how many feathers this person would have. And so a species had to almost go extinct for somebody to have luxurious head garb. And this is what luxury looks like. It brings the brightest and the darkest side of things. But I've just given you an idea of what we study and what kind of things we do. We do a lot of modern study also on this. You know, we look into, I'm just going to show it to you. We study Chinese culture. We look into, you know, modern China. We look into modern India. We look into modern, you know, MENA region and what is happening in luxury industry. We look into luxury and its dark sides in terms of, you know, it has increased counterfeiting. You know, mafias have started moving into this. We study things like, you know, how luxury is bringing bad behavior, such as, you know, unwanted sexual attention and all that. So number of different things that we study. We studied in more than 40 different countries and different ways. And so you're very welcome to join us in this journey. And who knows where it takes us. So I'm going to stop here. And I hope I've given you a little sense of what you can get from Southampton, top-end research and a lot of understanding. And over to you, Rami, you know, there where we can take any questions from students.
Brilliant, Bharath. Thank you very much for the talk. Thank you very much, Rob, as well for the insightful presentation. If anyone has any questions or anyone would like to ask, please do go ahead. I can take questions and filter them through. Let me have a quick look. I wanted to ask which year of the school is the best year to apply to Southampton? Any year really is a good year, but it depends what you're interested in, whether you're interested in doing a master's degree or a PhD. Degree as well. What's also important to mention is something me, myself, Rob and Imran were having a chat about. We are planning to have one-to-one maybe sessions, interview sessions with Rob, Parov and other academics in the new year. So please do stay tuned for that opportunity. It gives you more opportunity to answer, to ask questions specifically in the new year. But for now, if you have any questions you'd like to ask about our PhD programs, about our master's degree programs, even undergraduate, if there are any undergraduates here in the talk, that'll be amazing. So please ask anything and we'll be happy to answer.
So I also would like to thank you all for your presentations, great presentations and information. And let me tell them in Turkish as well. Sorularınızı Türkçe veya İngilizce olarak sorabilirsiniz. Tüm soruları yanıtlıyor olacağız. Yeah, there are two more questions.
Sure, Rob, would you?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, thank you. So if I take Dogan's question first, do you have digital marketing analytics program for master? Well, that's a great question because we actually have an MSc in digital marketing and we have an MSc in marketing analytics. Both of those are some of our two of our flagship programs within the school. And they're incredibly poised and well set up for our students to go on to incredible things afterwards. We have a very diverse group of students on both of those programs. and around a 99% rate of students going on to have graduate level employment within just 6 months of graduating. They're excellent. I think Parav and I would encourage here that both of those courses are taught by a combination of researchers and academics like us, but we also bring in top level practitioners, people who are working in industry to teach some of the parts of that course. For example, we have Ian Brown, who is one of the most senior people at SAS, and one of the most influential men and women in data, people in data recently. And he teaches a whole module on our analytics program. So hope that answers the question. Do we have postdoc positions? We do take postdocs, but they're on a project by project basis. So they would tend to be advertised on our school website, and then people can apply for them through that route. Can you give an example of where the graduates of these programs work? What a great question. They are in our school more generally. They go on to work for organizations like Google, Apple, Microsoft, Rolls-Royce, BMW, Mercedes, Unilever, Procter & Gamble, and then they set up their own companies as well. Our students go on to just incredible jobs, and then they come back into our classroom afterwards. Just to give you an illustration of that, just last week I had two of my former students come back and talk to my students. They're working in Adidas in Germany and in BMW in the UK. Do you have PhD programs in marketing? We sure do. We take students into our PhD program. There is a formal kind of route into this. We can provide you with the link to information about the PhD. It would be important for you to have a look at that first. Generally speaking, we expect our students to have a proposal for their PhD, find and engage with one of our academic staff, and then they can submit their application. In some cases, there may be scholarships available for PhD study as well. And that's the same for all subjects across the business school. Is it too late to apply for next year? Another great question. No, it's not. This is the most perfect time to apply for one of our programs now. We obviously have a number of scholarships available for students just like yourself who meet the criteria. This is a great time to apply for our school. We do, however, fill up on many of our programs, okay? So the sooner you apply, the better. But at this moment in time, you're all good. Rami, do you want to answer this? What are the requirements in A-level programs for undergraduate majors?
Sure, Rob. Our entry requirements for economics business degrees are 2 A's and a B. If you're doing A-levels. And the A's would have to be in subjects that are relevant to the program you're interested in doing. So an A in business, an A in maths, an A in economics, if these are any of the programs that you're interested in doing.
Sorry, Rami. There is a one hand as well.
Kubilay. Go ahead.
Thank you. I want to ask about, do you offer any merit-based scholarship for the international students? Because I was, it's the main problem about among the students here in Turkey, I think. I'm looking for the programs in the United Kingdom, and tuition fees are really high, and I would love to actually apply for some business departments, business degree programs. But generally, these merit-based scholarships are given for the applied sciences. Do you also offer in the business programs, in the master's degree? Thank
you. Yeah, we have scholarships available for business students. And as Rami said in the beginning, in the business school, there's some of the most generous scholarships for talented students. So we're looking for high-quality scholars. And when we find them, then we have scholarships available for them. And we can put a link into the chat for you to see how those scholarships work, Kubilay. So thank you. I'm sorry if I pronounced that badly. But brilliant question, by the way.
That's fine. Rob, thanks for the answer. What's the minimum CGPA taken into consideration? Usually we look for students who have a 3.0 GPA out of 4, which is equivalent to 76% if you're studying in a university where they offer a percentage out of 100. So, which is equivalent to a 2-1 classification in UK requirements, entry requirements. So a 3.0 would be, you have to have the word very good grading on your certificate if that's something that is offered. Other questions?
Rami?
You can apply right now. There's two ways. You can apply online or you can speak to Imran, who would happily guide you and help you through the process. Both ways are absolutely fine with us. So yeah, that's in regards to applications. Rob, you wanted to say something?
Yeah, I'm sorry for cutting across you, Rami, there. So I'm just gonna put my email address in the bottom there on the chat, everybody. If you are thinking of applying and you have any further questions, of course, Imran and Rami will be able to answer some of the questions about the process of applying. So please do reach out for them. But if you have any questions about the programs that we offer, the academic things, I would be more than delighted. In fact, you're absolutely over the moon if you were to write to me and ask me a question. Please don't hesitate to do so. So there's my email address there.
Brilliant. Thanks, Rob. Parv, I think there's a question or a comment for yourself.
I was just writing something around that.
Okay.
You have asked a very interesting question. To be truthful, yes. This is some of our students would ask. So, you know, you're already preparing yourself for Southampton, it seems. And I would say, yes, absolutely. You know, you see companies utilizing campaigns that would trigger at times, you know, very positive reaction in you. But at the same time, sometimes companies would be trying to show you to be, you know, if you buy our product, you will become prestigious, you will become, you know, they try and trigger that show off or conspicuous aspect of you. And that's not particularly right. But then we see that all the time. So companies utilize both sides, but we also study not just the companies, we also study us as consumers. You know, let me give you a very interesting example. You can see from my looks that I look like an Indian. I just don't talk like one. But, you know, if you think about Indian culture, which I'm pretty sure some of you are very aware of, because Turkey and India have long-standing relationships. And, you know, Indians eat the hottest food. They live in the hottest environment, you know. And what do they drink, you know? Most of the time, if you go to North India, they drink Scotch whiskey. And you feel like, you know, you eat the strongest of the food with the most amount of spices. And then you think about drinking whiskey with the top of it. You know, you should be drinking something like, you know, rosé type of a drink to calm your system down. But instead, they do something completely different. But because Indians love showing off. And I'm pretty sure you've seen some Bollywood movies and you've seen how Indian weddings look like. So I don't want to go further into it, but we see this dark and bright side, both sides, you know, and I've seen that in Turkish weddings too. You know, people go absolutely overboard in trying to show who they are to the society. But then you realize, who cares? So yeah, we find all sides of it. And thank you very much for that observation.
Thank you, Parv. Thank you for answering that. Does anyone have any further questions they'd like to ask? Anything about our requirements, about our courses? It's been a pleasure, obviously, today to see everyone and having everyone getting engaged and interacting in this session, which is absolutely incredible. So this definitely isn't going to be the end of us. You're going to see more of us very soon, myself, Rob, Parv, we'll definitely be traveling to Turkey in the new year. I hope you stay well and safe, and you and your families are well and safe as well in these tough times. We're still here maybe for another 5 minutes. So if you still have questions, please do ask. Alternatively, everything else would have to go to Imran. Imran, you're going to have lots and lots of questions very soon to answer. But yeah, we have a few more minutes for yourselves. Anything you'd like to ask, please do. Alternatively, it's been a pleasure meeting you all.
Rami, can you also share your email address as well?
Sure, my email address.
Let me write mine.
My name is Rami Al Musa, and my email address is below. So if you have any further questions, queries, even if it's business related, I can always forward them to Parv and to Rob, and they will get back to you very soon.
Brilliant. Thank you, Imran.
Thank you so much for your presentation once again. And we hope to see you in Turkey soon. Fingers crossed. Thank you.
Inshallah.
We wish you have a great day. And thank you so much.
Thank you, Imran. And we'd like to wish you as well a happy new year and a lovely Christmas for anyone.
Happy new year.
So, we'll speak soon and we'll see you all very soon. Thanks for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.